Your Facebook feeds will be monitored. Your tweets will be analyzed. They won't even spare your Instagram and your blogs. The government wants to read your emails. The Modi government has floated a tender hoping to deploy a social media analytical tool that will create digital profiles of citizens to gauge their opinions about official policies.
The tool ostensibly is aimed at penetrating social media platforms like Facebook, Twitter and Instagram to monitor and analyze social media feedback for government schemes.
Citizens, though, fear this move may infringe upon their right to privacy. Mirror now asks, will this data analytical tool infringe upon our right to privacy? And will the data analysis be misused? Let's debate.
Watching the Urban Debate on Mirror Now, Fede Souza. Good evening, viewers, and thank you for joining us. Here's the question that we're asking. So the government of India has floated a tender inviting companies to come forward to provide the government with a certain service. The service is basically for the government to be able to analyze social media, analyze individual users of social media, and figure out whether the responses to government services are positive or negative or neutral. Then design communication for those people who believe that perhaps the communication is negative. Now, here are the questions we ought to be asking about this. Is this surveillance and profiling, are we comfortable with it? Or if other private organizations are allowed to look at the feedback that comes in about them on social media, why not the government? If the government is going to read through my Twitter and Facebook, which are both public forums, is it a violation of my right to privacy? Should we be worried at all, or is this common now in the new digital age? These are the questions we're asking this afternoon, this evening. Joining us on the show, Prasanna S., lawyer with the Supreme Court, Ritesh Bhatia, security expert. Dr. R. Balshankar is a leader with the BJP. Adil Singh Bapariya is with the Congress. Ashish Dikshit, advocate with the Supreme Court. And Kumar Sambhav Srivastav is a special correspondent for Scroll.in, who wrote the article that we are talking about. Now, I'm going to start with our BJP representative, if I may. Mr. R. Balashankar, if you could tell us, please, what this social media analytical tool was meant to do. Why does the government need to read through social media and find out which one of us is unhappy with the government?
This is common in all democratic countries to analyze the media and also to create an understanding about what is going on. And in India, now that there is more than 30 crore people using the social media, it is very natural, and this is that there is no secrecy about it. And we all know that on social media, there is nothing called a secret thing, you know. Everybody who is familiar with it, you know that your message is not a hugely guarded secret. And government of India has no intention of interfering with the fundamental rights or the right to privacy or data privacy.
Well, that's fair enough, sir. You did say, of course, that this is all public data, and so there shouldn't be a problem, really. But if I look at page 29 of the document released by the government of India, among the list of things that it wants to be able to listen to and respond to, the following need to be supported for mobile insight. It includes email. Now, in point number B, it says platform should also be able to respond using workflow mechanism to the following channels and enable seamless conversation. It includes email. Now, email is not a public platform. And why does the government need to look through emails, and how will the government look through emails?
No, government has no intention of doing all these things. These are all a tender floated, and there is only at the discussion stage. No decision has been taken. And of course, if it comes to terrorist activities, underground activities, national security, there are issues involved in that. Even letters are intercepted. So it is very common knowledge that these kind of interceptions happen only in specific cases. Mm. It is not happening to the ordinary citizen. It is not happening to the common man.
So is the argument then, Mr. Balashankar, that the government needs to look through all the data, all the emails, in order to be able to find those who might be a threat to national security.
No, no, that is not the case, you know.
Okay.
On the social media, there is nothing called supreme secrecy, you know. And anybody who is familiar with the tool, they know this fact.
No, but in emails, there is emails. Email is a private exchange of, you know, of communication. So wouldn't that be a violation?
No, nobody has said that the government is planning to do that.
Well, in the government,
we're talking about a tender that is floated.
Yes, yes. I'm talking
that
about the
tender.
That is not
a government order. That is not a government decision also. It is only a tender.
Okay, so
the tender, there will be so many clauses. It is about the facilitation. It is not about the intention of the government. It is about the facilities the tender is talking about.
Okay, all right.
These are the facilities that they are asking for in the tool.
All right. Let me now bring in Prasanna S., lawyer with the Supreme Court. Prasanna, do you agree that this is just a tender? We perhaps shouldn't get so worried because it's not the it's not the government order. It's just a tender inviting companies to abilities.
Tender is floated after many of the decisions is taken. Now the expression of an intention by the government. In his response, there are a couple of things that I want to flag. See, one is we should not conflate secrecy with privacy. In fact, when the Supreme Court unanimously held in a 9-judge that privacy was indeed a fundamental right, it was a case that the government lost, by the way. They said they actually clearly distinguished because you put out something public, it doesn't mean you lose privacy over the data. Right? For instance, there's a number of metadata we put out in our discourse, and social media is not media, like analogy that is there. There's again a conflation there. So as far as social media is concerned, the number of details and lose privacy over those. That was made clear in the 9-judge bench decision. In fact, it upheld the decision of Justice Lahoti when it's with the bank. The bank can then disclose it to whoever you want. Then because you've already given it to a state entity. So that repelled, and it was made clear that just because you put something into a public domain, you don't lose privacy over it. In fact, for example, things like people we follow. Let's assume there are value judgments that are made by the government over. Let us see, I mean, value judgment. Prime Minister, for instance, from the kind of accounts that he follows on Twitter. But this is the kind of value judgments that tender software is trying to do, and that's a big problem.
Ritesh Bhatia, do you agree that this is a problem?
Major problem. Tender or not. It clearly says this is a government body, you know. It clearly says that this platform needs ring bells about Cambridge Analytica and things like that. You know, when we spoke about it last time, it clearly talks about surveillance the citizens. So,
how specifically, what is it? 60 degrees.
Please look at whatever tweet. So they are saying what are the sentiments of the public. What they want to say is that we want to introduce this particular product so that we understand that whenever we launch a program, the effect, sentiments, how are people reacting to it. But for that, they are going to read each and every tweet of mine, every message of mine, which is not the tender. The platform is expected to listen to your Instagram, LinkedIn, and email, and even the documents attached. I mean, it clearly mentioned this particular document. Isn't worrying? Isn't this like, you know, in the age of privacy? And today is 25th May. The GDPR regulation has come out in Europe, where, like, you know, they are so worried about their citizens that no personal data is going to be going out. And
so
here
see,
we are doing the opposite.
On page number two, point G, individual social media users and accounts. Is
clearly
that reason for concern?
Of course. I mean, you know, monitor individual social media social media user's account. So that means, okay, this is Ritesh Bhatia, what he's saying, he's putting on the film. The second, see the one below it also, which says the HH one. Message monitoring. This will help in understanding overall social media response to a message, tweet or data. So here we are going to be monitored completely.
We're going to be monitored completely. I want to go over to Kumar. Kumar wrote it's a special correspondent with Scroll who wrote an article on this matter. Kumar, what is your understanding and what responses did you get when you were researching and reporting on this article? You obviously spoke to a lot of people. What have you picked up about it?
Yeah, I mean, everybody was, especially in the context of Cambridge Analytica, you know, that in the US when it happened, this government and parliament went after it. But what happens in India, if this same kind of, the tool looks really powerful as making a profile of citizens and then also targeted campaign, you know, and then the tender document also saying that it's about the government scheme. So in an election year, when you want to target individual citizens on the basis of their opinions, negative, positive or neutral, and target them with the campaign, it's almost the same model. And then it's, you know, there's a fundamental difference that there a private company did it for a politician or a political party. Here it's government which is doing it. So then it becomes even more, it's blatant. So we need to see, as I said, that even earlier previous governments, not about Congress or BJP, the governments have been, for intelligence, have been doing surveillance of citizens. But for campaigning and for openly in a public document, in a tender, that's like the blatantness of it is really, I think, shocking for me and to the people that I spoke to.
But I want to take the question back to Dr. Balashankar. Dr. Balashankar, this is my question to you. Is this tool that will be designed, so you've called a tender and you've invited companies to come and design a tool for the government. Now, will this tool be used specifically for the government of India or will it be used as an analysis tool before the elections that are coming up? What is this meant for, really?
See, that is what I am saying. We are talking about a tender. It is a public document.
Yes.
If the government has any ulterior motive, the government would not be floating an open tender, first place. Secondly, it is an analytical tool. And this is not going to influence on the privacy of anybody. This is only program specific. It is about the projects of the government. When the government is floating a policy, when the government is introducing a new scheme, the government wants the citizens' response on the subject. And that is why this tool is being used. If there was anything secret about it, if there was anything ulterior about it, or if the government had anything to hide about it, or if it was a political tool, there would not have been a tender. There was no need for it. You know, there could have been secret ideas of getting it. So there is nothing like that. This is an open thing, and there is no conspiracy or no kind of, intention of interfering with the private citizen's freedom.
All right, Adil Singh of the Congress, please go ahead.
Well, Phil, let's understand first that a tender is floated by an instrumentality of the state only after a decision has been taken. It can't be that you float a tender and then you take a decision. It's the other way around. Point number one. Point number two, this is a conspiracy by the Modi government to create an Orwellian state. They want to undertake surveillance on the citizenry in this country. Let's understand what the BJP has been doing. The BJP has no faith in the citizens' autonomy or their privacy. This was made clear by none other than the Attorney General of India in the privacy matter, where he said that you do not have a fundamental right to privacy. So what is the intention behind this? What the government wants to do is that it wants to monitor the citizens, it wants to monitor the information which is posted by them, and then undertake selective targeting of these people. Now, we've noticed how on Twitter and Facebook, how any journalist or any citizen who has a contrary point of view is he's victimized on the internet, on the social media. Members of your fraternity, there are death threats issued against them. There are violent threats issued against them. So any person who has a contrary point of view under this government, they unleash a campaign to suppress and intimidate them. So this is what the intention is behind this move. They will create a database of individuals who hold a contrary point of view and then unleash their trolls, unleash their dirty tricks department, unleash the agencies which are under their control to target and suppress them. And I think in 21st century India, this would virtually usher the doors of an authoritarian and a totalitarian state, and we must guard against any such move of the government.
Ashish Dikshit, advocate for the Supreme Court, and you know, Ashish, so I still don't understand why the government would want a tool that could read through our emails, because there's absolutely no justification. Okay, I understand. Twitter is a public document. I've written something publicly. I'm aware of the fact that it's a public platform. So that is not a violation of privacy. But reading my emails is a violation of privacy. And why would the government want to develop a tool that allows it to read private emails?
You're entirely correct, Faye. As far as monitoring of the social media is concerned, I see no issues we should have. But if the government is deciding to watch my emails or my personal messages, this is outright attack on my privacy. And I believe what the BJP spokesperson has said, the government will follow it, that they do not intend to do that. And second thing, there are many issues which has been raised by the panelists, that you know it is going to be a totalitarian state or authoritarian state. I don't see it in this manner. Please, the government, what I can see is trying to reach out to the citizen to understand what is their opinion, what do they want from the government. I'll give you a very small example, that every government department is now on Twitter, and if you publish anything quoting them or by tagging them, they will instantly reply to that. So we cannot say that this is invasion into my right of privacy. And I am surprised at why in today's scenario we have so much of negativity and skepticism about the government. We need to understand that the government is something which we have chosen. And as per our constitution, we have enough powers. There is separation of state. If the government is violating any law, we have courts to look into it. Let the government do its job. Let government come out. We are, preempting everything, that it is going to create a completely government will supervise us, government will do this, government will do that. You know, using all these kind of adjectives and creating a hysteria around this situation will not serve the purpose. We need to understand what is the intention of the government. And yes, if intention is doubtful, we have all right to protest and even go to court challenging this policy or this notification.
Let me read out something from page number 34, I'll open the panel up for rebuttals right now. And this basically talks about analyzing headlines and breaking news on various channels and newspapers across the country and the globe. Because why does they want to do this? To find out how public perception can be molded in a positive manner for the country. How can nationalist feelings be inculcated in the masses? How can the perception of the management of India be improved at the world, and how the media blitzkrieg of India's adversaries be predicted and replied to and neutralized? How could social media and internet news discussions be given a positive slant for India? Now, I want to point out here that it doesn't say one particular government or political party. It says India. Why should that upset you?
No.
Can I come in, please?
Yeah, so basically,
yeah, one second, Ritesh, first.
So what do we mean by, this is one thing that was like really irritating me also, or troubling me, was nationalistic feelings be inculcated in the masses. So that means, you're going to read my tweets and you're going to see my messages and you say, okay, you don't have too much of nationalism in you. So now this is not done. And, answer that, why we should have trust in the government we have chosen. We have not chosen the government to do data mining and to do 360-degree surveillance. That was not mentioned in their, initially
okay,
when
so,
we had chosen
so
them.
Let me
and what about consent?
Yes.
There has to be some sense of consent over here. I should consent. Okay, fine, you can come and take my data. But here, I'm not consenting to it. I am not okay with this. And we are talking about privacy. And what about the data protection and other things? Now, that thing, the act is still over there. It is still to come out. So why again a hurry for this particular thing?
It could be argued as well. Adil saying it could be argued as well that since Facebook and Google and all of these other guys have your data, why does it make you uncomfortable if the government has your data?
Well, Faye, in the guise of nationalism, we cannot have a police state. the BJP seems to believe that there were no patriots before the 26th of May 2014 and that patriotism and nationalism have born after Mr. Modi became the Prime Minister. How absurd is that? We Indians are patriots. We do not need a certificate from Mr. Modi. Today in this country, Faye, and I can challenge you, if you write anything about fuel prices or if you write anything which has a contrary point of view as opposed to the BJP, you'll be trolled. Forget anybody else. They'll ask you to go to China, they'll ask you to go to Pakistan. That's the condition today in this country. Free speech is being curtailed. Let's understand this. And the gentleman before me said that, you know, there are checks and balances. Let me point out, when a journalist from Tribune had pointed out how Aadhaar data was being misused, we had a situation where she was hounded by the police. There was an FIR registered against a whistleblower who actually wanted to make the Aadhaar system more foolproof. So please understand, this government does not care about your rights. They only care about winning elections. They're creating this tool to undertake voter profiling, to undertake data profiling, and then they will use all this information to selectively target the citizenry. That's the intention. They've already co-opted a section of the mainstream media. We all see that every day on television. A section of the media has become a mouthpiece for the government, and now they want to capture the social media through this medium.
Well, Dr. Balshankar, this is there are various questions to you right now. First of all, you said that this is just a tender, we should not worry about it. But if the government has asked for a certain tool to be designed, isn't that the first clue that this is what the government wants to do? Why would the government ask for a tool that it has no intention of using?
See, the point is, I think the Congress spokesperson is talking about the regime. Under its rule, you know, like during emergency, they had imposed censorship. They said that there is no fundamental right. They have invaded into every private aspect of our life. They are talking about that. But under the BJP, BJP is ruling in 22 states, and BJP has not imposed any kind of restriction on any freedom of speech. And that is why the Congress people are talking all this nonsense. They have been abusing. Whenever the government is coming out with any new policy, they have been scaremongering. This kind of scaremongering is basically a negative attitude. The government, you know, when the government came itself, they said that there is no freedom of expression. They have been saying about, you know, suppression of public freedom. And every time they are saying, and it is falling flat on the public side, because they know it. The public know that this government has been elected for a certain purpose of nation building, and this nation is being ruled properly, and there is no infringement into anybody's freedom, and that is a fact, and we are enjoying that freedom. That is why we are discussing it today, and that is why people are expressing their views, and the best kind of abuse is being held at the BJP leaders and the BJP Prime Minister. So this is a very strange situation. We are only scaremongering, and we let it come out as my advocate friend was saying. So we can always judge it, and there are remedies. If there is any problem, we can always go to the judiciary. You can challenge it.
You know, but there's a problem there, Dr. Balshankar. There's a problem there. If once the data is out, then we could, yes, you're right, go to the judiciary. But by that time, can we put the data back? Can you put the genie back in the bottle? Once the data has been accessed, once the tool has been created, Ritesh.
No, you cannot do that. And
Sir,
but then you know what, you're saying the courts are there. You know, every normal or like a middle class citizen cannot afford to go to the court as such. And what happened? What about this, sir? Location-based insights. Here we are saying that the tool should have the ability to get the exact location of the particular user. For what?
No, we have under our democratic system, we have many pillars which are protecting citizens' rights. The parliament is there, legislatures are there. Judiciary is there, the press is there, all these things are there, and they are all free. They can always question any of these things. And we can always ask if the government is, you know, stepping out of its limits.
Prasanna disagrees with you. Yeah, please, Prasanna, go ahead.
The first thing is, we've completely gotten the role of the judiciary to be very, very limited. It is not just there for us to challenge some law or a state action. It lays down the law. It is supposed to shape the way the government acts in the future. In August last year, there was a 9-judge bench judgment as, as unanimously, as unequivocally as possible. It is laid down that there are three parameters by which you infringe people's privacy. It said communication privacy also exists as an aspect of the right to privacy. In order to infringe privacy, it said it laid down three guidelines. One, there has to be a statute, there has to be authority of law. So in this case, let us ask Dr. Balshankar, where is the law? And number two, it says it has to have a legitimate purpose, and the legitimate purpose should be of a purpose that is necessary in a democratic society. Where is the need in a democratic society to fictionalize the news or confectionalize the news to correct the public perception, etc., etc., when even more basic stuff like the right to information is something that we have to fight for every day? There are vacancies in the Central Information Commission. There are vacancies across the Information Commission. The institution of the Information Commissions are under huge stress, where there are, 2-year-old cases that are still being heard by the CIC. And the third one is that the state action has to be proportionate, and the measures have to be commensurate with the right that you are infringing. So where is the proportionality here? So, we tend to say big brother, it's not just the government listening to whatever we say, it is also making value judgments over us as a people. And the second point that I want to make with respect to the role of the constitution itself, we have to understand that trust is not bestowed or conferred on the government, it still needs to be earned. So the very idea of the constitution is to actually limit the powers of the government. It is not to hand over the entire trust to the government. We could have just lived in a monarchy if we had to do that.
Okay, so there are some things in this document that I would like to understand better, and I'd like for my audience to understand better as well. One of the things is conversation archive, ability to see historic conversation of each user in a reverse chronological manner, along with the ability to merge conversations across channels. Could anyone on the panel explain to me what this means? Why do you want to be able to see historic conversations of each user? Ritesh, do you know what that means? What does that mean?
No, it's pretty vague as such, because, conversations of what? WhatsApp messages, or they're talking about conversations on Facebook, and if at all they're talking about such kind of conversations, are they actually getting into my profile? Into my Facebook Messenger or something like that? So what exactly do they mean by that? There is another discrepancy over here also. They say that they want live screens over there, and which is going to be called as the Social Media Command Center. And over there, they want to monitor real-time monitoring of marketing efficiency, customers. So who are the customers of the government? Did they mean citizens as such?
No, but
did
they mean technically, if we're talking about a government service, then anybody who's accessing that service becomes a customer.
Competitors?
I don't know.
So the next page also says about influencers and competitors. So this is also something that needs to be explained.
That's a good... Ashish, do you want to tackle that? If the citizens are customers of the government, then who are the competitors?
No, it's not about customer. We are, I think, reading too much into it. It's like government is trying to understand what a citizen is expecting from the government. See, every day we go on Twitter and say things about the government, that we are happy on this part and we are happy on, or we are unhappy with particular thing. So the government is only trying to get into this thing, that how we can provide better services to the citizens. It's like, rather than we approaching the government has approached the citizens. And I am not in agreement with this thing, that if emails are to be accessed, it's my right to privacy, the right to privacy is there. It can be subject to larger public welfare, but you cannot interfere with my right to privacy, like emails or my personal messages. So a balance needs to be drawn. What I would like to say, that any law has to be balanced. You cannot say I have a right to privacy and I will not let anything happen. I will not give any data to anyone, or I will not do anything. It's something which has to be weighed with the larger public interest. And so I think one point I would like to make, that there was this panelist who was saying that I have posted something on social media and I still have my right to privacy over there. You know, this is like saying something, I've kept something on the road and I want no one to take it. If you're putting something on social media, obviously there are people reading it, obviously people are following you, obviously everything will be subject to public criticism. So I don't see how something which is on social media can be said that it is violation of my right to privacy. My privacy can be limited to my personal messages, my personal emails, not something which I write on Facebook or
anything. Ashish Dikshit, could you explain to us one more time what our problem was with Cambridge Analytica?
Hey, can I come in, please?
See, our problem with Cambridge Analytica was that it was a private body which was working for political gains. Here we have some institution which is called government, which is by the people and it is for the people. And if government is doing any fault, we have remedies available to us. You cannot compare a private body with a body elected by the people of this country.
But Ashish, this is the same thing. We are talking about data mining. Now, whether it's done by the government or whether it is done by the private body, we are again talking about data mining.
Kumar Sambhav, what is the difference between Cambridge Analytica and what's happening in this tender?
We expect everything.
Yeah.
See, we expect everything from the government.
Can I come in? Yeah.
But we don't want to share anything with the government. Let government do everything to us. But Aray, sorry,
but you know what? This is sorry. Let me tell you what this means. One second. Let me tell you what this means, Ashish Dikshit. What you're saying effectively is, if our building society say, I have to give you security, you want to keep the building secure, allow me to put the CCTV camera inside your house and inside your bedroom. That's the only way I can keep the entire building secure. You want security? I want to be able to see inside your house. That is where we draw the line. The government's job to provide services. You cannot infringe on our privacy to do it. One second. Kumar Sambhav, please.
I am not saying.
Can I come in, please?
Yes, Kumar, go ahead. Kumar, first, please.
Hi. Even on that, I'm with you. I'm not saying someone should come into my bedroom.
Yeah. I was trying to say that, you know.
Kumar, go ahead, please. Kumar.
Yeah. I just wanted to say that even when they're saying that I have put something on social media, I lose control over its privacy. I would understand when government tells me or somebody tells me that all my historical conversation over social media would be monitored. I would be careful. I would not be putting so much on social media. So I don't know if that's what somebody is going to do with my content. I put it for some conversation with some purpose, not for creating my profile. That's one thing. Second, when it comes to consent, you know, in the context of India, it could be so messy. You don't know in masses in rural India, when you take consent through these surveys or fitness or whatever, they don't even understand what is the meaning of consent. So there are different apps that take our consent. So that's what all needs to be first spelled out in the privacy law. And the third point I wanted to make is that when the law is still not been up, it's not still being drafted, and the government is coming up with something like this, a project like this, one wonders, and there are questions, that whether a window for this has already been created in the law or they are already planning to do this. So how does this match, like, when there is a drafting process for law is going on and a project like this is coming up?
Right. I have one more question for the panel right now. Do you believe that this sort of surveillance will lead to an increase in the number of arrests we are seeing because people feel they have insulted a national leader?
Yes.
So you forwarded something on WhatsApp that turned out to be offensive to a national leader, leads to an arrest. Will there be an increase in that kind of arrest and that kind of policing? Adil Singh, go ahead.
Say we're entering, the BJP wants us to enter an era of dictatorship where there is only one man, one ideology. They want to create a monolithic state. And that's the problem, because that runs counter to the idea of India. The BJP today behaves like a PR company, and that's why they see everybody else as competitors. And I think that's the reason why perhaps the word expression competitor has been used. The government has deliberately kept the phraseology and the expressions ambiguous, because when you keep it ambiguous and vague, there is always scope for subjectivity, and that's where the government can step in and abuse and misuse its position. So let's understand, the intentions are not noble. The intentions are very insidious. Going by the BJP's past track record and the fact that we're in the election year, the BJP BJP intends to use all this information to hound, to victimize and suppress individuals and citizens who hold a contrary point of view, which is dangerous to a democracy.
Well, on the 23rd of April 2018, and I'm reading a headline from the Times of India, Congress demands arrest of BJP leader for derogatory post on Rahul Gandhi. Adil Singh, isn't that the same thing?
Yes.
Well, I haven't read that. I haven't read that news item. But as far as the Congress party is concerned, we encourage exchange of ideas. That's we are open Congress. To critique. We never suppress individual voices. Faye, under the BJP, we've seen members of your fraternity. I just read today some very esteemed members of your fraternity are being threatened. Threats are being given that we'll kill you. There have been pornographic videos being circulated of members of your fraternity. This is the level to which the BJP has stooped.
Well, I want to point out to our it's audience that journalists are threatened in every regime. This is not specific. Also, and here's a question, Prasanna.
Yes.
If this tender goes through, if there is a company that creates for the government of India a social listening platform in which they can find out which of us is posting against them and actually be able to profile us, do you really think a new government run by a different political party will say, this is bad, we should destroy it, we should not use it anymore?
Well, thankfully, we are not at the mercy of political parties alone, which is why we have a great constitution. And in my view, it will get struck down right at the outset, because this is the only thing I thought the government can defend something like this is by telling us that it is a bit of an April Fool joke that got released a little belatedly. But it is not so. Not so. I mean, you have a 9-judge bench laying down saying that you cannot do this without a law. Where is the law? They said, okay, parliament is the first bulwark against incursion of fundamental rights. Where is the law? Why does this not have to go before a parliament? It's just so many things wrong with it at so many levels. I am just not able to start at one place and end at another.
So for our viewers who have just joined us, this is what we have. There is a tender that has been put out by the government of India inviting companies to design a tool for the government. This is how, if the government needs some work done, this is how they do it. They have to put out a tender. At least 3 companies need to apply and they pick one among those. But what is interesting about this is the business or the kind of tool that the government has asked for. It is a tool that can go through social media, can read everybody's social media, be able to profile the people who are influencers, profile what they're saying about the government, whether that is positive or negative, whether that works for the government or against the government. It can then design messages and send it out specifically to these people to change their minds. One hopes also, Mr. Balakrishnan, one hopes that this will be the government and not the BJP, and we should not mix the two. How will we ensure that if this tool is designed, yes, that it will be used only by the government of India and never used by the BJP before the next election? Because that would be unfair and that would be a violation of privacy. Because when we agree to give, if our consent is asked for, if we agree to give our data to the government of India, we're not agreeing to give it to a specific political party. Is there a line drawn between the two?
Exactly, that is what I'm saying. You are talking about a tender and we are talking about a tool and there is no government policy on it. Then government has not announced any policy decision on this and no decision has been taken on this. And that is why I'm saying about developing a tool which is an instrument for analyzing data. What is there so much to be scared about? And what is there if any political party is scared about saying that this will be used
if
against
I may,
the government?
But sir, you said it yourself, Mr. Bal, Mr. Bal, Dr. Balchankar, you said
no,
it yourself.
First of all,
there is no policy, there is no document, there is no decision from the government, and already a tender has been floated. It's a very specific tender. Why would the government float a tender without making a decision, without writing up a policy of this matter? And unless it was clandestine.
No, that is the point, No, there is nothing. If it is clandestine, you can ask any secret agency to do it. And if there is anything secret about it, there was no need for a tender. Because this about developing a tool, this is a technology that we are asking to develop. And the country will need it. Country can use it. But that does not mean that it is anyway going to limit the freedom of expression or limit the freedom of our citizens.
The platform should be able to identify influencers' bases, attributes like follower count, clout score, even specific handles to enable insights as well as priority-based workflow engine. Ashish Dixit, could you tell me what that means, other than to find out who's writing what about the government based on their Twitter handles and their clout? And once you find that out, what will the government do with that information?
You know, if the followers, number of followers on Twitter is the criteria, I'm sure you must be an influencer. You will fall in the category of influencer.
Which is why I'm asking these questions. What will the government do with the information? So, okay, let's since we're talking about it, let's assume I'm one influencer that has now become a person of interest for no other reason other than the Twitter following. Now, let's assume the government finds on my Twitter handle a tweet criticizing the policy on the price of petrol. In fact, if you looked right now, you would find one tweet a day for the last 12 days criticizing the policy on petrol. Now, what will the government do with that information? Why are you interested in it? If you will drop petrol prices, I have no problem. But obviously, from the behavior of the government in the last 12 days, you have no intention of doing
obviously,
that.
Obviously,
so then, what will you do with this information?
Threaten you.
No, they have. You never know. You never know what, see, they want to know that information so that what is expected out of the government. I, as a citizen, really? If not, I am not satisfied with a particular thing, I can write it, obvious. Yes, they can. They should do this thing. I think that is the intention. See, and one thing very important which you asked, that we need to separate government and BJP, government and Congress. That separation is by way of the oath which the minister or the officer or the prime minister has taken while taking
office. Oh, please don't make me rely on
that. And that will also apply when they relinquish the office.
No,
they have to.
That's not good enough. I'm sorry, Ashish Dixit, that's not good enough. You are going to have to give me concrete evidence of how, in the run-up to the 2019 election, all of the various ministries of the government will not use this tool to push agenda, to threaten people who are criticizing them, and to use the word neutralize has been used in this document. Neutralize those who are criticizing the government. Tell me how you will ensure, as the government will ensure, that this doesn't happen.
See, government is not here to threaten anyone. Have you ever seen a government handle on Twitter threatening anyone? It is not possible. It is practically not possible. We have trolls. We have all kind of people who can do whatever. But the problem is, we are only talking about the government. The government has no intention. And I expect this is my government, and I expect out of them that they are not going to. No, it's not possible. You can say anything. They will unleash agencies and they will do this and they will do that. It is not possible. Because we have a rule of law in this country, the Congress or BJP.
But if that was true, why have you done this document? Why have you? You are threatening us. You are saying go to the judiciary. Now, at this rate, we'll have to approach the Supreme Court for everything. After we've had a constitutional bench tell us we have a fundamental right to privacy, why would you put out a document like this, which is an obvious violation of that right to privacy, and then say, go to the Supreme Court if you want to?
But
citizens of India shouldn't have to go to the Supreme Court every other day.
When the Supreme Court says, when Supreme Court says that right to privacy is there, there is also a reasonable restriction on that right. Every constitutional right under the Constitution is subject to reasonable
restriction. And what is that reasonable restriction that you want to know who is criticizing the government? That's the reasonable restriction.
No, you want to know who has a grievance against the government, and that can be sorted out.
It's not the grievances we are already putting it up. Why do you really need a tool for it, Ashish?
I'm opening this up right now. It's very interesting. The government wants to know which of us has a grievance against it so that grievance can be solved. It's basically. Yes, go ahead. Adil, go ahead. It's customer service.
Under Article 19, sub-clause 2. Under Article 19, sub-clause 2, there are reasonable restrictions, grounds on which freedoms can be curtailed. One of them is public order, friendly relations among states, national security. There are 6 criteria under which the freedom can be curtailed, subject to a law, and that law being reasonable. Now, criticism of the government is not included under Article 19 too. So therefore, that's unconstitutional. Prima facie, that's unconstitutional. So the argument being advanced on behalf of the government, the panelist who ostensibly speaks for the government, is flawed. It can't be that you include something which is not there in the constitution. There is a nine-band judgment which clearly lays down the law. Anything to the contrary is an infringement of our fundamental rights.
Here's my next question. Here's my next question. Anyone who wants to answer this, why does the government need such a careful tool to look into social media to find out what the problems in the country are? By merit of being the government of India, shouldn't you already know what the problems are and what services need to be fixed? Prasanna, do you want to take this?
See, this is a...
Yes.
Yeah, I mean, I mean, they may try. My sense is that that's going to be a lot of money gone down the drain. People are not going to give this information to the government. There is enough limitation on natural language processing already. It doesn't get satire. It doesn't get sarcasm. So therefore, a lot of social media communication now is going to be laced with a lot of sarcasm and satire, and therefore it may very well be counterproductive to the government. We've seen that progressively the government has become more and more and more data hungry. They think personal data is their data. It is a national resource to be monetized, exploited, and used for whatever purpose that they want. And this is, we citizens will find a way to fight back.
All right, citizens will find a way to fight back. I want to thank all of our guests for joining us this evening and helping us understand what's going on with this. We will, of course, keep a track on this story to find out, like Dr. R. Balashankar told us, if this is just a tender and the government has not made its decision yet, there's no policy yet, when there will be a policy, we will bring you an update on this tender, viewers here on Mirror Now. For now, we have to take a quick break. But in the meantime, here's where we're going to leave it. The government has put out a tender. We know that for sure. The tender has invited companies to come in and look and create a social media tool that will look into Twitter and Facebook and Google and emails. And that's a worrying point. And all of the other social media that we use, it will look into messages. It will look into people. It will look into criticism. Is this surveillance? Is this a violation of privacy? Why does the government need this much data? And can the government draw that line and separate itself from its political interests? We'll keep a close eye on this story for you because it impacts each and every one of us. Stay with Mirror Now. Thanks for watching.